we developed this particular product for a customer, and during the process, customer decided that their internal requirements changed. So, but we continued developing this particular product and decided we are going to use it internally. So what I'm going to tell you is our experience in using one of our products internally at WSO2 and what we have learned. So the particular product that I'm going to talk about is WSO2 App Manager. And to explain what we have done here, I'm going to do a little bit of role playing. So I'm Sam, but I'm Sumedha. But in this case, I'm Sam from WSO2 sales team. Now, this particular statement has several key elements that I want to emphasize. One is Sam, an identity, a user within our system, our LDAP. Right? And then WSO2, the organization, right? And sales team, a role, a set of privileges, set of permissions that I get because I'm in this particular team. Now, with this particular identity, as Prabhat explained yesterday during his identity modeling session, I log into this particular URL. This is actually a real URL. Right? So, what is so significant about this? It's apps.wso2.com, a subdomain under wso2.com. You can even visit this, but you wouldn't be able to proceed because you need a valid WSO2 credential to log into this one. So once you log into this one, you'll be presented with the login screen, and you log into this one, you click on the login button, and you'll be taken into the WSO2 IDP, identity provider. So basically, this is an usage of our identity server for our internal use. Okay? So we have connected this into our LDAP. So I log in using my credentials, actually Sam's credentials. So what happens after this? I log in, I get redirected back into the application, apps.wso2.com, and I see a bunch of applications that are used internally within WSO2. Right? Now, in this particular slide, all the applications that I have are web applications, right? And all these are applications with real usage. Say, for example, if I start with this one, this the carpooling application. Somebody wants to pool cars. This is like if I get a guest within WSO2, if I want to create him a Wi-Fi account, this is the application that they are using. Okay? Or else, if I want to request dinner. This is the application that we are using. This is our Jenkins. Okay. So various different applications that are listed based on my role, the application that I'm supposed to see. Then I can also subscribe to this application. So basically, I can click on one of these applications and tell I'm going to use this. Okay. So from that point onwards, these applications are going to appear under my subscriptions. So that the next time that you log in, you will be redirected to this particular page. From here, you click on the application, and it appears as a central point for you to access all the applications that you're supposed to use, and you are required to use, and you are required to know. Okay? So there are more things in this particular store view. You can actually categorize different applications based on tags. So that you know, say for example, if I want to quickly create an account for a guest that I'm having, I just click on the infra tag. And the particular application, set of applications that I'm interested when I want to deal with infra gets appeared. So it's a app store from one side that is having classifications. And I can even search, there's a search that is on top of it. And then, like, we are also at the background, we are working on getting some NLP type of processing where, like, if I type in guest, it will start showing me certain things that I have to use when I have a guest within WSO2. Then, what I do is, in this particular one, I'm Sam from sales team, right? And I want to know, before I talk to a particular client, what are the patches that we have given for that particular client. Right? Now, for that, within WSO2, we have an application called Patch Management Tool. Right? And what I do is I click on the application, and I'll be taken to the detail page of that one. And here, I see certain specific details about the application. Right? Like, if I'm very new, I'll be shown user guides, what this application does. In order for me to use this application, what do I have to know? Right? Various things, various domain-related things about the particular application. But in this case, I have been there for a while in the sales team, so I know what this application does. I just click on the application, and I will be taken into a slightly ugly place that we are working on. I'll be redirected into the IDP, and I'm already logged into the store. And IDP recognizes the fact that this guy is Sam, has already logged into the store, and it returns back me to the correct application because I'm in a single sign-on session. So this is the real application that I want to use. Right? And as you can see here, I'm already logged in. Now, this is an application that WSO2 has internally done for the benefit of sales and a couple of other engineering teams. Right? Now here, I, as Sam, I perform whatever the things that I want to do. And I'm a bit of a technical sales guy, so I happen to notice that, the gateway has sent a SAML response into my application as well, which I'm going to talk about in a while. So let's just try to analyze what just happened behind the scenes. Okay? I accessed the enterprise application store. I logged in, I tried to access an application, I got automatically single signed on into that particular application, and I can access that. So I'm happy because I get to see all the applications that I'm allowed to see and supposed to see, so that I don't have to, if I'm new, I don't have to go about asking, what are the applications that I'm new from sales team, what are the applications that I'm supposed to see, what I'm supposed to use. Because it's already in there. It's already developed by a separate team and published so that it is delivered right onto your browser. Then I'm happy because I'm using a single set of credentials to access all these applications. I'm trying to, right now we have discovered we are using close to 60 applications out of the 30 are listed in there. And it's a single set of credentials that we have to use to access all these applications. So I'm happy because I don't have to remember anything. And I also happen to see how to use this application because there's a central place alongside the application which tells, this is what it is, these are the guides, etc. And I also can request features, I can give feedback for the application developers through the portal itself. And I can even create gyras. So now comes a different user, D. D is from WSO2 CIO team. Now she's a developer, and she is writing applications for internal usage. Okay. So in her case, she sees the system as from a different perspective. Her objectives are she wants to develop applications for internal usage, and she wants an effective channel to distribute those applications. There's no point in developing an application and just keeping in her laptop or just taking to a source repository without anybody else knowing it. Okay. So she, using this particular solution, she can just publish the application and start appearing on everybody's application store. And she also realized that whenever she's writing applications, there's a repetitive thing that she's doing. She wants users to authenticate themselves, and she also wants users to get authorized. That's a repetitive task that she does in each and every application among the many other things. So she's looking for a solution where that also can be eliminated or like handed over to another one. And she also wants like there's a central repository of users, and each of those users are having various attributes, telling like food preferences, telling like working hour preferences, home telephone number, different things, the different devices that the user is using. Right? So she wants to use those attributes within her applications as well. If she's developing a mobile application, she wants to know what is the type of device that the guy is having. And she also wants to know the usage statistics or different analytics on the application that she's right. Are these applications are being really used? If so, during what time? What are the most like preferred or favorite URLs? And how long a particular person stays within that particular page. And she also wants to centrally manage authorization policies for applications. So for example, like for sales team, these are the particular URL contexts that the person can access. And she prefers to use something like Zachmuller standard to define those authorization rules. And like in the Sam's case, Sam's providing feedback. She also would like to receive feedback on like how her applications are doing, and easily report issues, and also like see analytics, and also these applications are using APIs, so she wants to have some integration between those applications and the backend APIs. Now, what she does is, she uses a particular component called application publisher to achieve some of these things. So this is the publisher component of this particular product, app manager. Right? So this allows you to create a proxy web application. Right, still I'm talking about web applications, proxy web application for a web application that you already have or that you're going to develop. Okay? And in the process of creating a proxy web application, this is just capturing a bunch of very regular details. It also has certain advanced configurations where you can break a web application into a bunch of resources. And you can specify URL patterns, you can specify HTTP verbs, you can specify policies that act upon these URL patterns. And I'm sorry about this screen, but you can define these policies. In this case, we are using SACMA because we happen to have SACMA capabilities within the platform. And then you can apply those SACMA policies. You can give it a name, you can apply those SACMA policies against these given URLs. Now I'm still talking about I'm still within an application. Okay? Then I also can apply different throttling policies to tell, okay, this particular application can only be accessed this many times, or only during these times, by these particular users. Different policies on different resources. And she also can control the detail view a particular ordinary user would see. Examples, guides, all that. So there's a separate documentation management component. It's not a comprehensive CMS, but it's rather a place where you can go in and attach different documents into a particular application so that end users can get access to those. And this is something very important. She can have lifecycle control of the application that she's going to publish. So there's a lifecycle associated in this particular process. So she starts creating an application, and like if she's not done with the documentation, maybe she's not happy with the icon, she can hold it without appearing in the application store. Now, if you guys are familiar with API management world, pretty much a similar process. In here, we are doing it for the applications. And why this is important? The purpose of why, like, application lifecycle management, and why having a separate tool to do this is important is APIs are there for a purpose. People like create APIs to create applications. Now, if you don't have a management tool to deal with applications, you're going to end up with the same problem that you have in with the APIs as well. So this particular lifecycle can be configured. By default, there's a particular simple lifecycle that you have plugged in. But it can be customized. You can plug in your own lifecycle, and you can even plug in a BPL process into there. And this is the publisher's view. This is what the D would see. The status of all the applications that have been there. And she can click on these applications and get details. And same process for mobile applications. But at this point, since I'm explaining a case study of what we have done, we don't have any mobile applications developed, so I don't have any further screens on the mobile applications. But this actually takes you through a same wizard. It asks you what is the type of platform that you want to upload, et cetera, and you can continue. So once those applications are in there, once those are running, once those are available through the store, D also wants to see the statistics about these applications. So there are various level of statistics that we present out of the box, but these can be extended based on your need. So one such statistic that we show here is you can break the application to different pages, and you can see like how the pages are being accessed. Or you can see these kind of like multi-dimensional view. You can see what are the applications and what are the total number of hits that application got. And you can get a drill down view if you click on this particular bubble. And this one tells you about the response times of different applications. This one tells you about like overall subscription statistics. Let's say like if you publish an application but nobody uses that, nobody subscribed to that. Through this you can figure out, okay, the application is useless. This shows similar statistics in a different view. And like I said, like you actually create a proxy web application against a real application. So this is a endpoint breakdown view of what is happening. But these statistics are not limited. You can actually customize it. You can write your own analytics. You can get your own visualization plugged into the particular product. So both these users coming from two backgrounds, one a sales guy who just wants to access applications, and the other one, D, a developer who wants to develop applications for internal usage, uses the same ecosystem, same platform to manage application delivery, application lifecycle management. So this is a little bit of a component, or rather a functional overview of what happens. So I talked a little bit about I started with the application store, where end users would see all these applications. And for applications to appear on the store, it needs to go through a publishing process, and it is this application publisher component that controls that particular process. Okay. Once the applications are published, when users are accessing those applications, for certain type of applications, those calls happen to go through the application gateway. So it is from here that we receive the call. If the user has not logged in, we call in the IDP, get the user logged in, and maybe retrieve certain profile attributes kind of things, and get that back and call the real application behind. So, and of course, like during this process, we can also do certain monitoring and analytics, which I'll explain in one of the slides. So in a nutshell, what we have is a proxy web application for a real web application and an application gateway. And within this gateway, between the proxy web application and the real web application, bunch of interceptors, or in our terms, we call it handlers, because we use WSO2 ESB for the application gateway. That's the implementation mechanism. So we have like interceptors for doing single sign-on, statistics collection, policy evaluation, and those handlers or interceptors can also be plugged in based on the requirement. And so far I have only talked about web applications, but we support multiple types of applications, mobile applications. Now, in the case of mobile applications, it doesn't go through the gateway because mobile application does direct API calls. So the mobile application support is mainly for delivery, and it also connects with WSO2's mobile device management, so that whenever I click on an application on the App Store, it actually gets installed onto my device through the mobile device management. And we also support, not in the last release one, but it's there in the current repository, sharing web links. And also we are in the process of adding command line application support, like what you do when you get apt-get install. So I happen to mention, when you go to the IDP, you retrieve certain set of things. Right? Now what happens here is, this is the proxy application that I mentioned. From the proxy application to the real web application, there are two things that you can pass in, either a SAML token or a JWT token. Now both of these tokens takes certain things about the user who logged in into the backend web application, so it can take decisions about, okay, if I receive a SAML token or a JWT token, right? There's a user who has logged in, and this particular one contains certain attributes about the user, or maybe like roles, or like different validity periods. So the backend application can make certain decisions. Similarly, like similar set of attributes are available on the SAML token as well. And the particular process of somebody signing up into the application store, or particular process, application store comes next. Particular process of somebody publishing applications into the application store can be extended via workflows. And somebody signing up for the applications and somebody subscribing for an application can also be extended, so that you can have your app store open, but you can control who signs up for a particular application. And we also support publishing statistics through Google Analytics. For that, you need to modify the backend web application to have this particular snippet, and you need to include the tracking code. So this is pretty much the current functionality that we have, and the current deployment that we have. It has been a real good experience, because we happen to use something that we have developed for a client for our own purposes. And there are certain future work that are happening at this particular point. So if you guys have been to the new gateway presentation about the fast lightweight gateway, we're actually thinking of replacing the enterprise service bus with the new gateway, because we want the gateway to be lightning fast and lean. And also the throttling capabilities, we are thinking of re-implementing using CEP. And decoupling the application store. So right now, like what I've showed you is just a web-based application store, but that is not the case. If you really want to have your application store on the mobile, so it's a mobile catalog. Mobile app catalog. So we have all these functionalities are defined as APIs. So it's just a matter of implementing another application store for a targeted platform. And of course, like we are thinking, trying to architect to see how this can be used to deliver applications for the devices, or to deliver firmware updates. Because on one side, there's a developer who writes applications of firmware, and on the other side, there could be an end user, a human user, or a device that has subscribed to receive updates. So it's a perfect place where one side updates, the other side get notified and gets it installed based on the policy that is specified on the device to receive automatic updates or not. Okay. So this is pretty much what I wanted to present. This is an overview of what we do with WSO2 App Manager. That is the product name. And just to share our experience on getting it used internally. Thank you.